Could I invite everyone to move to this side? Sorry. And then everyone to move forward. So everybody definitely in front of the camera. But I would suggest, I just want to try something, because I feel like when we sit closer together, we tend to respond more. Do you know that? When you sit further apart, the atmosphere feels too stale. It's like the air is too, I don't know, it gets too thin, and you run out of breath. So can we come. There's seats here. If you want to sit at the front, it's okay. But I feel like if we come closer together, people tend to respond more, because this is just a Bible study, and I'm going to be passing this mic around, and we're all going to take turns to read a verse each, okay? So does anybody not have a handout? Have we run out of handouts? Well, not yet, right? Who needs a handout? Okay, there's a few here. One at the front. So these studies, if it hasn't been clarified yet, these are the sort of studies that all my Bible workers give. This is what we teach them to give for all the doctrinal studies, for those that are non-Adventist, and for all those that are Adventist, okay? In my church, you're either giving Bible studies or you need Bible studies, all right? You're either help or you need help. Why? Because everybody's born into the kingdom of God as what? A missionary, all right? So you are either a missionary or you're a mission field. So I don't really care how long people are baptized for. I find that many Adventists learn different things from these studies. Not because they're any different, but it just shows that many of us, we have still much to learn about our Adventist faith and doctrines as well. So anybody else still need a handout? Thaddeus, did you get one? Oh, okay. All right. So what we'll do is we'll, as you have the questions in front of you, we're just going to go through this bit by bit, and we'll have discussions. And of course, if you have questions, feel free to just raise your hand and we'll stop and we'll go through it. But let's go right to question number one. Hopefully you will learn a different perspective of the cross. As you know, many people know that Jesus died on the cross. But there are many details I feel that are left out that are important for us to appreciate the extent to which God went through, not just Jesus, but the Father went through to grant us our salvation. So let's start in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 4. Let's go there. How many levels did Jesus have to come down in order to be born into this world? Hebrews chapter 1. Did I say 11? Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 4. Sorry. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 4. So this is talking about Jesus when he's in heaven, okay?
Hebrews chapter 1, verse 4, being made so much better than the angels, as he had by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they.
And of course, you cannot take my word by faith, but if you read the three verses before that, you will find it's talking about Jesus. And Jesus, when he was in heaven, right? It says he was better than who? Better than the angels, okay? So at least we know the angels, of course everybody is, but the angels are one level below God. Now, let's jump over to Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. It's okay. All right, go ahead.
Verse 9.
Two.
2, verse 9. But we see Jesus who was made a little lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone.
So now this is describing when Jesus became man, because he tasted death for everybody. And we see now he's made what? A little what? Lower than who? Angels. So now we see Jesus as man. He came down a little lower than the angels. So when Jesus became human, he came down two levels. So question, what's one level below human? What's one level below human? Animals, okay. What's one level below animals? Huh? Death? No, like a living organism. What's one level below animals? What? Plants? That's like inanimate, okay? Like they don't feel pain when you cut them. So what's one level below animal? Insect. I know you said it, but I want to prolong it a bit. She said it right at the very beginning. It's no fun when you have no fun to push things around. Okay? So look, for us to understand this, all right? It's like us becoming an insect, okay? But here's the thing. Jesus did not come like Adam, 15 feet tall, 100% brain power, right? But even if he did, okay? He didn't, but even if he did become like a human, just like Adam at the very beginning, do you know that's a really big sacrifice? How would you like to be a cockroach? But the most beautiful cockroach in the whole world. You will win Miss Universe cockroach. Would you like that? You're the most symmetrical, you know? You look perfectly symmetrical on both sides. Would you like to be a cockroach? But you're the most handsome, smartest, fastest, strongest cockroach in the whole world. Are you with me? Jesus did not become perfect Adam. He became just like us, tired after one day, 6% brain power. You know what I mean? He didn't even come like a perfect human being. But even if Jesus did come like Adam, perfect human being, it's like us coming as a perfect cockroach. It already was a sacrifice just to become human. Do you understand that? From the very beginning, the minute that Christ was born, his life was marked with sacrifice. He did not come to play. He did not come to be served. He did not come to be king. From the very minute he was conceived in the womb, his life was full of sacrifice. Do you know that? Even Adam was not born a baby. Pop quiz, does Adam have a belly button? What do you think? Does Adam have a belly button? Who said no? Who says yes? You know how you answer these questions? It doesn't matter. There are questions that people will throw out during a Bible study, just for the sake of asking it, but if it doesn't pertain to salvation, it doesn't really matter. Some say yes, some say no. I mean, what do you need a belly button for? Anybody know? It's just there. What is it for, Dr. O? It's a sign that you had a placenta cord. Okay. Yeah, no belly button. He didn't have a scar here. Or maybe God took the rib out from his belly button and made a scar there. We don't know. But these sorts of questions, sometimes it doesn't really bear much meaning. You make sure you just gloss over it when you're teaching other people, you see. Learn to be able to filter the questions that are important and those that aren't. But you see, Jesus, he became human just like us. Short, tired, dumb. That was us. That was Christ. His whole life was marked with sacrifice. But let's go now, fast forward. We skip his whole life. We go right to the very end. We're going to look at the last moments of Jesus' life, okay? So let's now go to Matthew chapter 26, and let's read verse 37 and 38. We'll read one verse each, okay? So just one verse and then pass the mic on. So we'll start in Matthew 26, verse 37. Oh, question, yes. Oh, Jesus came as a seed of Abraham, okay? Expound on that. Like, what does it mean? Well, it's very simple. What I use that for, the reason why Jesus came as a seed of Abraham, actually, that's in Hebrews chapter 2. If we want to, we can go there real quick. We don't look at this verse in our study here, but in Hebrews chapter 2, and it says there in verse 16, "For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham." Why does it not talk about Adam? Because you see, Adam had two natures. He had a nature before sin, and he had a nature corrupted with sin. Right? But every person after that had a nature what? Corrupted with sin. He wasn't born with sin, because if Jesus was born, if we are born with sin, then, if we are born with sin, that means Jesus was born with sin as well. So, definitely not. But when it says that he took on him the seed of Abraham, he definitely did not have the nature of Adam before the fall. Who understands this phrase of a hot topic when I say the nature of Christ? Who understands this? The nature of Christ. You understand what I'm talking about? Raise your hands. Okay, Dr. Ho, I saw one hand, a couple of hands. So most of you don't understand the nature of Christ, which is good, but this is a big debate even within our Adventist church, okay? And I think I should highlight this because this is one text that brings it out. The nature of Christ is an argument as to whether Christ came with our fallen nature or Adam's before sin. Okay? The nature of Christ is this. And the reason why many people discuss about this and we go back and forth in discussing this and researching into it is because there are many quotes that seem to support this, and then there are many quotes that seem to support this, okay, within the spirit of prophecy. Did Christ come like perfect Adam? Did he feel tempted? Because Adam, when he was looking at Eve and when Eve was talking with the serpent, there was no voice in their mind saying, "Eat the fruit. Eat the fruit." Do you know what I mean? In our minds, you should have learned this in the fall of man 2 weeks ago. Those two voices that you hear are real. Okay? It's called your what? No, it's not called your conscience. It's not called your sinful nature either. It's called your higher power versus your lower power. Do you remember that? Was that the day that only four people turned up? Like in our brain, there's a higher power and a lower power. You need both. Here in the higher power, there is the intellect, the reason, the judgment, the conscience, the willpower. All of that is there in the higher power. In the lower power, there's just two things, appetite and passion. But when Adam and Eve were created, the higher power was in control of the lower power. Perfectly in control. The brain was balanced perfectly. But ever since man sinned, the lower power became the overriding power to the higher one. And that is why you don't have to teach anybody to sin. They will automatically sin because the lower power is the one that is mostly in control. And that's why you have to teach children how to exercise their willpower. Yes. Why was Eve what? Why did she succumb to temptation? Because the temptation was an external temptation. You see, what we have today that Adam did not have, Ellen White calls inherited tendencies to sin. But what did Adam and Eve do that we also do now? Cultivated tendencies to sin. And cultivated tendencies are when you put forth the action, and the more times you do it, it deepens the impression. Do you see that? But Adam and Eve, when God created them, they didn't have any inherited tendencies to sin. They didn't have a bend towards evil. You know, if they had kids before sin, their kids, they would have just left them alone and they would have grown up perfect. You know what I mean? But now you have to like, don't touch that. Oh, hey, I told you. Oops, smack, smack, right? So you have to train them. And so you have to train them to overcome this because our higher powers now are weakened. And so the reason why the nature of Christ, I'm sorry, this is not our main lesson, but it's an important topic to talk about nonetheless. The reason why nature of Christ is important is because it deals with the nature of sin. When does a man or a woman become a sinner? Because if Christ was born like us, with a fallen nature, that means none of us are born sinners. Do you understand that? But if Christ cannot be born like this, because the minute you're born with a fallen nature, you're a sinner, then Christ cannot be that. He has to be this. Does that make sense? Raise your hand if you're confused. Oh, okay, so let me explain this again. The nature of Christ is important to understand because if Christ was born into the world with a fallen nature, what I mean by a fallen nature, you inherited from your parents the desire to do evil even though you haven't done it yet. Like a person, maybe a parent who smokes, I don't know if this is really true, I'm just using an example, but a parent who smokes and they have a kid, that kid might grow up with a desire and a tendency to smoke. You know what I mean? Okay, a better one is like hot temper, right? If you have a hot temper, I've seen it with my kids, truly, because I have a hot temper. My daughter, she's come out with quite a strong personality and character, and it results in a hot temper. Do you see that? So we inherit certain things from our parents, but most of these things are bad if you don't cultivate them properly. Now, if Christ was born with a fallen nature, right? And we believe that when you're born a sinner straight away. You know, the minute a baby comes out of the mother's womb, you cut the umbilical cord, the baby's a sinner. How many of you believe that? Okay, so a few of us here. The premise of that, and the problem with that is this. How does a baby confess? What if it dies? Does it go to hell because it didn't confess? So every kid below the age of 5 that can't speak, didn't confess, they'll die a sinner? You know what I mean? So there are loopholes in that thinking. So if we believe that the fallen nature equals you sinned, then we have a problem. Do you see that? But if Jesus came like perfect Adam before he sinned, we also have a problem. Do you know why? Because none of us are like perfect Adam. And perfect Adam had an advantage over us. True? So if Jesus came like perfect Adam, and he overcame, and then he says, you do the same, and we're like, Christ, we're not like you. How can we overcome? Right? That's unfair. No one exists on the earth like that. Then we have a problem there too. So, in order to understand the nature of Christ, you understand the nature of when we become sinners. And it is not when you are born. This premise is wrong in terms of fallen nature equals sin. No. The fallen nature just equals the desire, the tendency to sin. That's how Christ came. And I can prove it through and through. If Jesus came like perfect Adam and he couldn't be tempted, right? Then why would Satan tempt him? Don't you think he's pretty stupid? You tempt somebody that doesn't feel tempted. You know what I mean? Yes. Right. Yes. Oh, sorry. He had to come as human. So Christ had to come as human. So he didn't come like an angel or God, right? Right. Yes. Yes. He could be. He could be. Yes. You're right. You're right. Sorry. Wrong premise. I just got it mixed up with something else. But here's the thing. Christ had to come like man, like us today, because he came to redeem us, not angel, not even Adam before sin. So he had to be like us, or else he could not say what? Follow me. Right? So he had to come fully human, but yet he was tempted in all points without what? Sin. Even as a baby, Jesus was not a sinner. If he was, he could not be our Savior. Okay? So it's just this is 5-10 minutes on nature of Christ. We could spend hours on this, okay? Could spend hours. But the basic premise I want you to understand is we are not born sinners. I know there's a verse in Psalms 51, I believe it's verse 4 or 5, that it says, in sin did my mother conceive me. You see, that's what you call an ambiguous text. In other words, was the mother the sinner? Or was the baby the sinner? You could argue till the cows come home and you would never get a clear answer. So never, 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 never base your understanding on one text that is not clear. Okay? So, impossible that we are born sinners, yet Christ was not. Do you see that? At what age do children become sinners? I haven't figured that out yet. I'm still observing my kids. But if you have insight onto that, let me know. Yeah? I know Ellen White says that the first 8 to 12 years of a child's life, the parents are as God toward them. So the parents forgive them. I'm sure our Father in heaven would forgive them as well. Okay? So that's the only conclusion I've come to as to what age they become sinners. We really don't know. All right? Any other questions before we move on? Yes. Sure, sure. Okay, so does it have anything to do with faith when it talks about Abraham? Definitely. But when it comes to looking at the whole context of it, you probably have to dig a bit deeper and start from Hebrews chapter 1 all the way up to chapter 2. But usually when it talks about this, chapter 2 is mostly about Christ becoming human. Chapter 1 is about Christ as God, and then chapter 2 is Christ as man. And so here it helps me to... So we're at question 2, Matthew chapter 26, verse 37.
Matthew 26, verse 37. 26:37. And the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed.
Verse 38.
Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me.
So how did Jesus feel when he was here? In which place? What was the place that we know it is? Garden of Gethsemane, right? How did he feel? Sorrowful, right? But why? This is Thursday night. It isn't Friday at the cross yet. But why did Jesus begin to feel sorrowful? Let's go to the next verse, verse 39.
Further, and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt.
Okay, so Jesus prays this prayer, and what is this prayer all about, basically? What is it all about, in a nutshell? God, I don't want to what? don't want to die? He doesn't say that. There's nothing about death in there. I don't want to what? Drink this cup. Okay? And look, this was his humanity crying out. He did not want to drink what was in this cup. And he prayed it 3 times, okay? So if you continue reading throughout this passage, you will find that he came and he found them asleep. Then he went back and he prayed again. He prayed 3 times, God, I don't want to drink what is in this cup. So, what was in this cup? This is the next question in question number 4. Let us go to these following Bible texts. Jeremiah chapter 25 and verse 15. Jeremiah 25.
God of Israel unto me, take the wine cup of this fury at my hand and cause all the nations to whom I send thee to drink it.
What is in this cup? Wrath. What else? There's one more word that the Bible used there. What was it? Fury. Okay? I think we are more familiar with the word fury than wrath, but of course, when you're in the Adventist church for this long, you definitely know what the word wrath is all about, right? Good or bad? Bad, right? Jesus did not want to drink this cup of wrath, this cup of fury. But let's go to another text, Revelation 14, verse 10. Revelation 14, verse 10.
Revelation 14, verse 10. The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb.
Whose wrath is this? It's the wrath of God. Okay? This cup that Jesus had to begin to drink was the cup of God's wrath, the cup of God's fury that would be poured upon sin and sinners at the end of time. Right? And of course, if we go back to Hebrews 2:9, I know we've already read this, but remember in Hebrews 2:9, he became man to taste what for everybody? Not wrath. What was it? Death, right? Jesus became man to taste. Was that my pen? Oh no, here it is. He came to this earth to taste death for every man. Okay? Why? Romans chapter 6, verse 23. Romans chapter 6 and verse 23. A familiar text for all of us.
For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Why? Why? Because of sin. The wages of sin is death. But do you know that Jesus did not die the mortal death? In the Bible, there's 2 types of death. Are you familiar with this? There are 2 deaths. And it's not very creative. We just call it first death and second death, okay? The first death is the death that everybody dies. No matter how good or bad you are, it's not a respecter of persons. It's the mortal death. The second death is the death that is caused by sin. And yes, I know. You know, when Adam and Eve, they ate the fruit that they weren't meant to eat, right? God quickly shut them out from the Garden of Eden, and they eventually died. But the death that they paid for is not the death that Jesus came to die on the cross. When Jesus died on the cross, he did not die this death. Are you with me? He died the second death. Do you know how I know? No? Ask me why. Okay, thank you. Just kidding. Because if Jesus died for this death, we have a problem. People have already died this death. You know what I mean? They should be resurrected straight away. Or how does Jesus solve that dilemma for people that died before, like King David, right? Definitely we'll see him in heaven. But he died this death. And if Jesus, thousands of years later, dies on the cross for this death, then how about the people that died before? Do you see that? That means they should we should never, ever, ever, ever die this death ever again if we are saved, if we believe in Christ. But even now, we still continue to die this death. Do you see that? So that's how I know when Jesus hung on the cross, he did not die a mortal death. He was not killed by the nails in his hands and the nails in his feet and thorns pressing on his forehead. This is not the reason why he died. The cross, the Roman cross, was created in such a way to keep the person alive as long as possible. They were to be alive for days. It was an instrument of torture. The two thieves were still alive at the end of Friday. Did you know that? That's why they took them off the cross and broke their legs so they couldn't run away. But Jesus, he died within a few hours. Not because he was exhausted, because he didn't drink any water the whole day, right? No. He died the second death. His death was not natural. Any questions about this? No? Clear? Sorry? He was pierced? Yes, but that was after he was dead and they wanted to check to see if he was alive, so they pierced him. And then blood and everything came out. So if he wasn't dead by then, he would definitely be dead after that.
One question.
Yes.
He died only 3 days. He was resurrected after 3 days. If I were to die the second death, I would die forever. It doesn't seem fair.
It doesn't seem
fair.
Fair?
Or just.
Why?
If he died for my death, he should die forever. Because if I died for my sin, I would be dying forever.
Yes, but that's why he had to pay the penalty. And the Bible, Ellen White says, he laid down his life and he took it up again.
Yeah, but if I laid down my life for my sin, it would be forever.
Absolutely.
And Jesus did it only 3 days. Seems mm-hmm. like it's not fair. It's not equivalent.
That's the thing with salvation. It's never about being fair. Just make sure you accept the free gift. He died for all in the whole world, yes? We never die for anybody?
No, I mean just in response, because Dr. O said like we die forever, but Jesus died for 3 days and then rose up.
Yeah.
I mean, the thought that came to me is that he died for the whole world. He died for everyone. So, mm-hmm. isn't that fair?
And, you know, this is where the nature of Christ is really a mystery. Because Jesus was fully God and fully human at the same time. And it was only God that could die. Because the law that was transgressed was created by God himself. You know? And so, that's why an angel could not die for our sins. Even though they fell at his feet saying, no, let us die instead. He said, no, you can't. Sorry, there was first Dr. Tian, then Dr. Dickie Ng, and then comes.
I think in answer to Dr. O's question, Satan said to God, you are not fair. Why you took Moses' body and resurrect him? He should die eternal death. Everybody who sinned should die eternal death. Why you raise everybody who believe in Jesus Christ? It's not fair.
Before the cross.
Before and after the cross. Whatever it is who believe in Jesus Christ, Satan will contend that everybody should die eternal death. Why God is not fair to raise everybody who believe in Jesus Christ?
Well, if that was really a true argument, it would be sustained in our current system, but it is not at all. It is fair because one more than human paid the penalty for it already.
That's the reason. That to counter Satan's argument.
Yes. Know,
Jesus died for all of us.
Yes.
And God is fair to everybody.
Yep. So, I mean, do you know Moses was resurrected by faith? Did you know that? Moses was, the reason why in Jude chapter 1 verse 9, you know, Satan is contending about the body of Moses, because Satan really has a valid argument. So what did Jesus just do? I rebuke you. And he just took him to heaven. Did you know that? He didn't even bother arguing with him. But if Jesus failed, if he was not able to die this death for us as a perfect sacrifice, Moses would have to come back down and die. So he was resurrected by faith, and Enoch and Elijah were translated up to heaven by faith. Dr. Dickie Ng.
In your explanation for the first death and second death, I think another way of looking at the first death and second death can be a temporary death, the first death. The second death, it can be explained as eternal separation from God.
Yep.
And that's what actually Christ suffered, eternal separation. Even though it is just 3 days, it's as if, you know, I mean, why was he so afraid? Why was he so sorrowful? Because of the nature of the eternal separation, which for the sinner who would not or did not repent will face in the second death. So
yes.
If you don't want to call it eternal death, you can say it's just a separation from God.
Yeah.
No one actually need to suffer the separation from God now for us, for those of us who put our faith in Christ.
Yep. Thank you. We're going to elaborate on that later. We will. So we're going to come back to that.
I'm not sure about the statement that God is not fair. And I'm not sure fairness is measured by 3 days or 30 days or 30 months or 30 years. I question back to the fundamental here. The wages of sin is death. Christ never sinned.
Mm.
He probably is the first person who never sinned who has to die.
Oh, he's definitely. There's not even a probably.
Yeah. So, yeah, he's definitely. So the fact that he bears everybody's sin, even though he has not sinned,
yes,
he has already proven to all of us that it is possible for us to have eternal life.
Yes.
So, hence, the second death bears no weight to us anymore and has no effect to us anymore. So, I would read it that way in looking at why that makes a difference, because Enoch's in heaven right now because he's too good to be. He's seen to God that is probably sinless in a sense, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the other characters that are mentioned in the Bible. So I guess the part here that is important is to look at the fact that he never sinned and he did not deserve to die.
Yep, absolutely. Enoch and Elijah definitely did sin. I have no doubt in my mind. I'm not trying to dumb down their actions at all, but we have very clear evidence of Elijah's slip up. Right? But yet he was still translated. But let's move on. Any other questions? No? Thank you for that sharing. But yes, I forgot that. He was definitely, and he has only been and ever will be, the only perfect person that still had to die. You know, that is definitely not fair on the flip side. Thank you. But look, I just wanted to clear this because this is where I introduce the topic of first death and second death. And if people are not clear, you just bring them to Revelation chapter 21. And the last two verses, hell thrown into the lake of fire, this is the second death, okay? That was the death that Jesus paid for. If not, if he paid for this one, we would never ever die again if we are saints. But it still happens, right? Okay, so let's continue. I'm just going to jump to question 6 now. Why was Jesus crucified? How did the Jews view this? And verse 13, Galatians chapter 3, verse 13.
Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree.
how did they view this? As what? Curse. That Christ was being cursed. He was rejected by man. And of course, if you want to go in more details, you will see that everybody, from the thief on the cross to the soldiers to those that passed by, they all mocked him. And they thought that he was cursed, rejected by God. But now let's go to the next question. Why did Jesus cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me on the cross? Matthew 27, verse 46. Matthew 27, verse 46.
Matthew 27, verse 46, and about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
So why did he cry out, God, why have you forsaken me? Let's go to the next verse, Psalms 22, verses 1 and 2.
My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roarings?
Verse 2, O my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and I am not silent.
So here he's quoting from the psalm, as you can see, but I want you to notice it says in verse 2 now, after my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me? In verse 2 it says, I cry, but you don't hear me. And in the night season, and I'm not silent. So God, in a sense, was not hearing what he was crying out. But why? Next verse, Isaiah 59 and verse 2. Why was Christ not being heard by God? Isaiah 59, verse 2.
Have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear.
Why does the God not hear? Because of sin. It was very clear at that very moment, he had sin in his life. Not of his own doing, but he was taking upon himself the sin of the whole world. The sin of every person that has ever sinned before. In the past, it was all those that had confessed their sin. In the future, it would be of all those that would ever live, but then would then confess their sin after. But he had sin in his life, and that's why the Father had to separate himself from him. Sin and God cannot exist together. Do you see that? And that's why he was crying out, why have you forsaken me? Forsaken by man? Man looked at him on the cross, oh, you're cursed. Forsaken by God. And so as Christ hung in midair, he was forsaken by everybody. Everybody, heaven and earth. Do you see this? He had to walk the road to Gethsemane all by himself. He, as he hung on that cross, paying for the sin of everybody, he was all alone. All alone. And why does this become such an important detail? In the next question we ask, had Jesus ever experienced separation from the Father before Gethsemane and the cross? Let's go over to John chapter 8 and verse 29. John chapter 8 and verse 29.
And he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that pleased him.
Even on earth, Jesus was never separated from the Father. Do you see that? Even when he became human, let's not even talk about him as God. He was always with the Father when he was in heaven. But even as he walked this earth, he was never separated from the Father. The Father has not left me, he said. I do all those things that please him. And you know, on the cross, for the very first time, Jesus felt something that he had never felt before. It wasn't sin that crushed his life out. Do you know that? Jesus died of a broken heart. This is the first thing that contributes to Christ's death on the cross. He felt something that from eternity past, he never felt ever before. Separation from the Father. I can only little imagine what that's like. Fathers, I think you'll understand this when I say this. And maybe you never experienced this, but I experienced it with both my kids. When my wife, for the first time, had to go out, and my daughter realized she was gone, she cried like the whole world was about to fall apart. Are you with me? And that's why I can only little imagine what that felt like. You know, when the little baby who's old enough to walk around and crawl around, mother's always there. But now you turn around and it's only dad. It's not good enough. You know what I mean? I can only little imagine what Christ felt, but from eternity past, the Father was always by his side, and now he's gone. An emptiness that cannot be filled with anything else, he felt for the first time in his life. And this is what began to crush his life out. But that's not all. That's not all. Question number 9. Jesus already knew that he'd be raised in 3 days. Why does it seem like he could not believe that? Why does this become such a big ordeal, okay? I mean, Jesus was the one that told the disciples, they're going to kill me. After 3 days, I'm going to be resurrected. I mean, knowing that does not make it any easier to bear, does it? Like, everybody, I know tonight I'm going to die. But when you face it and you're in the midst of the situation, it doesn't make it any easier. But why did this become such a big ordeal? Let's go to Matthew chapter 17, verse 23. Matthew 17, verse 23. This is where Christ, he quotes this, or he speaks this to his disciples. Matthew 17 and verse 23. Let's go there.
And they shall kill him, and the third day he shall be raised up, raised again. And they were exceedingly sorry.
So he told his disciples, I'm going to die, right? After 3 days, don't worry. I'll be raised up. How did Jesus know this, though? How did Jesus know that this was going to happen? Did he know that when he was the minute he was born? No. Did Mary tell him? No. Then how did Christ know that he would die on the cross and after 3 days, be resurrected? Let's go to John 12, 49 and 50. John chapter 12, starting verse 49.
Verse 49, for I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak.
Verse 50. Kenny, are you able to read for us? Okay, no. Verse 50.
And I know that his commandment is life everlasting, whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, so I speak.
So tell me, how did Jesus know that he would die and be resurrected after 3 days? His Father told him. Okay? Father tells him, don't worry, when you die, you'll be resurrected after 3 days. This was not the ordeal that Christ faced. What Christ didn't anticipate, or maybe he forgot, I don't know. But what he didn't anticipate was the very hand that would lay the death blow was the one that gave the promise. Are you with me? It's like a son goes off to study. And he's off in a distant land, and the father writes back and says, "Son, come back. Come back for Christmas, okay?" And the son says, "Okay, I'm coming back." But then the father warns him. The kingdom has changed. On the way back to the palace, you're going to go through a bad area of town. And when you get through that area, just keep running. Just keep running. I'll be with you. And so sure enough, the son's on his way back to the father's palace. And sure enough, he gets through this bad area of town. And the people say, "Hey, there's the son, the king's son. Let's get him." And so he begins to run. And he begins to run. But it's not fast enough. These people catch up to him, kick him to the ground. And there he is on the ground, and he's covering his head, you know, trying to protect himself. And he's like, where are you, Dad? Where are you, Dad? And he turns around, and guess who he sees? Who does he see? He sees his father. And he's the one with a stick ready to beat the son to death. Do you know how I know? Because that cup that Jesus had to drink was not a cup of sin. It was a cup of wrath. Whose cup? God's wrath. At the end of time, the person who punishes sin is not Satan, because he's part of the group that's being punished. The person that punishes sin at the end of time is the Father. Do you know that? In Revelation 20, the Bible says, fire came down from heaven, out of heaven, from God. It is God, the Father, that will punish sin at the end of time. And the very thing that broke Christ's heart was not sin itself, it was the penalty, because who had to punish it? It was his Father. Do you see that? As Christ was hanging on the cross with sin of the world upon his life, the Father was the one that had to beat him and punish him. And many times when we look at the cross, we think, poor Jesus. And we forget the Father who had to suffer on the cross as well. Parents, you would rather die than to let your children be harmed, isn't it? Let me take it. But it was the Father who had to turn around, and for the sake of everyone else that was mocking him, that was cursing at him, that rejected him, he had to beat his son, kill his son. And this is a picture of the cross that we don't see very often. Yes, eternal separation. We see that. But I'm telling you, it's much more. Do you see that? The Father was the one that had to punish his own son for you and me. Yes. Could I imply that Jesus did not know that it was the Father? That's why I said, I don't know. Yes. In that sense, yes. But did Christ know? I don't know. He probably wasn't thinking about it. But you know, when you're in the midst of a down period in your life, and your parents come and rub the salt into the wound, oh, it hurts even more. You know what I mean? Whether you know or not, I mean, let me tell you an experience. When I was younger, I wasn't a very smart kid, and I don't think I am. I'm a C average student, okay? When I was in high school, I thought I got a really good grade. I got 91.1, all right? That to me is an A, right? I was like, wow, I did pretty good. I came down, I was so excited, and I told my mom, I got 91.1. You know what she said? Typical Chinese mother. Is that all? And you know, you kind of expect it. I know my parents well, and you know, they expect higher than of that from me. But even in the heat of the moment, when you hear that response, it's like a ton of bricks. You know what I mean? And so I can't understand the exact psyche of what Christ was going through, but when he's in the midst of suffering and he looks up and he sees what? The hand of God not coming down in comfort, but to punish. I tell you, it's not something that you would brace yourself for in the midst of all that you're going through. He knew that he was already dejected and rejected by God, but now comes the final thing that the Father has to do to punish sin. You see that? And that's why, that's what I believe finally killed Jesus. It wasn't a natural death. It was not by any means a natural death. I know many of us don't see the picture of the cross this way. We always seem to tend to forget the Father sitting on his throne up in heaven. He wasn't just sitting there. He had to do a strange work that the Bible says he has to do at the end of time. Something that he's not used to doing. But more than that, he had to do it for his son. To his son, sorry, not for his son. He didn't have to do it for us, but to his son. Would you ever beat your child to death for someone who hated you? Or let me put it in an easier way. Would you ever beat your child to death for a friend that you grew up with, a buddy, your classmate, your best friend? Would you do that? No. But Christ, while we yet sinners, while we yet hated him, while we yet cursed at him, he died for us. Do you see that? This is the picture of the cross that I believe will break many people's hearts. Question.
I have the question, which is not trying to minimize God's role or his suffering, but I think if I were a father that I had to beat my child to death, and know that in 3 days' time I can resurrect him, I think it'll make it easier to beat my child to death.
All right. In some sense, but you know, we know that we'll be resurrected with eternal life in the future, but it's so hard to even sacrifice the little for our own lives even now, isn't it? But that's what Abraham definitely had to think walking up.
Yeah, Hebrews says Abraham knew that God would send sacrifice in place of his son. He knew, knew that his son would be resurrected, sorry.
Hebrews 11. He had faith that his son would be resurrected.
Yeah, that's right.
He didn't know.
He didn't know, but he had faith that his son would be resurrected.
Yes, yes. He had the promise of that.
But that goes back to my first question, you know, that it's not fair that Christ was resurrected in 3 days. As a father, I could beat my son to death if I knew that he was going to be resurrected in 3 days.
That's a question we'll never know.
I want to add what Dr. Danny have said. It's easier for father to beat the son to death knowing that he will be resurrected in 3 days. But the father did not know or not sure whether the son will accept that or not. Jesus could have said no. Jesus would have choice of saying that I don't want to take the cup. Do you think the Father have guaranteed that the Son will accept the punishment?
Oh, of course. I mean, but I guess at the moment after he took the cup, it made it easier. I guess that's the point that we're trying to make there. But look, in all of this, what we need to understand is the overriding picture of God's love for humankind. That's the point that you have to make in this study. The first, I hope you're understanding that these first six studies so far, it's all about the love of God. It's not about anything else. It's just the love of God, you know. And that is what must form the foundation for everything else that you teach them. Okay? But let's continue. Oh, yes.
Responding to Dr. O's question just now, I think
it's not about what's going to happen later on. I think we need to look at what is happening during the moment when the thing's happening. Like for us as parents, we punish our children for their wrongdoings. It's for their good. But is it because we know it's for their good, so we enjoy doing it? You know what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
The moment we do it, we know it's for their good, but we do it with pain.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's my answer.
Yeah, you should see my wife. She's crying before she even hits the kid. So it's definitely not easy. Definitely not easy. But look, when it comes to teaching this doctrine, okay, there are many other things that we could talk about, but you got to keep it simple for those that you just got to give that alternate picture that you add with the Father about the Son, yeah?
Listening to the talk, I was just thinking, because I asked the question why it mentioned Jesus take the seed of Abraham. Is it correct if I would say that because like you say, like Dr. O mentioned that, you know, it's easier for it's easy for the Father because he knows they're going to resurrect him in 3 days. And then like Abraham, when he sacrificed his son, he know that God would not take his son away. So when the Bible described the words after the seed of Abraham instead of maybe seed of any other, you know, a person, but it mentioned Abraham because the elements of faith is a very important part in to do with this salvation.
There definitely could possibly be a connection, but we're not sure about that. We're not sure, yeah? But yeah, good thought, good food for thought. Let's move on. Dr. Kwan, you had? No? Okay. All right. So let's finish off the last two questions, and we're almost done as well. Why was there darkness and earthquake while Jesus was dying? Matthew 27, 45 and 51. Let's read those two texts, shall we? Matthew 27, 45.
Now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying,
Verse 51, and behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent.
Okay, so there was darkness, there was a great earthquake. Why? Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 22. Deuteronomy 5 and verse 22.
These words the Lord spoke to all your assembly in the mountain from the midst of the fire, the cloud and the thick darkness, with a loud voice, and he added no more. And he wrote them on two tablets of stone and gave them to me.
Okay. So, where was God? He was in the darkness. Yes, God dwells in the light. God also dwells in darkness. Right? That is why there was darkness round about the cross, even though it was midday until 3 p.m. For 3 hours, there was darkness there. And it was definitely a supernatural event. It was not just an eclipse because there was light all around everywhere else. But God was there, even though the sun could not feel his presence. And one more, Exodus chapter 20 and verse 21.
The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was.
So, darkness, God's presence. He was there, but he was doing a work that was very foreign to him. Okay? He was doing a work that was very foreign to him. And finally, why did Jesus and the Father endure pain, rejection of man, and separation? Let's say it together. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It wasn't just Jesus who suffered. For God, the Father, loved the world that he gave. Gave in what way? He had to lead him through Gethsemane to be sacrificed. Do you see that? But lastly, John 15, verse 13. John 15, verse 13.
Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends.
Greater love than, no one can show any greater love than this. You know, there's this Ellen White quote that I really love. She says, it's something like this. God could, the very least to save man has been done. It's the cross. Yet God could not do more to show His love to us. Do you see that? The very least that was required in order to save us was the cross. Yet God could do no more to show His love to us. You know, God, He's played His last card. Do you know that? He's shown whatever love He has to us, He's done it. There's nothing else that He can do. It's like, God, do you still love me? Are you kidding me? He's saying, I can't show you anything else. I have shown you all that I could to show you that I loved you. There's nothing else that He can do. All of heaven was poured out in this one gift. It's the only gift. And nothing else can He do to show us how much He loves us. But He did it for you and me. And look, the ball is in our court. Christ is now waiting for us to respond. You know? Since 2,000 years ago, the ball has always been in our court. He's waiting for a response from you and me. What are you going to do? What do you want to do? You're still waiting for Him? He's done. He's waiting for you to respond. You see that? And so I hope you get a different glimpse of the cross today. And you know, when you're teaching others, what you're seeing before you here is the handout. I know that you could probably bring this back and go and study on your own, you know, because the Bible texts are all there. But these guides are designed in such a way to empower the teacher. This is not like an Amazing Facts study guide, okay? There's no commentary there. There's no interesting facts that you can read. This sort of study guide is designed for a teacher to lead someone through it. You can't go back and fill it all out because some of it won't make sense to you unless someone is there to explain it for them. Or unless, you know what I normally do, I don't actually like teaching with study guides. So what you have in front of you, I actually hate doing it. I like to do it in such a way that I just have it, I'll teach it to you, and I normally go back and say, here's a study guide, you go back and redo it now. And put in all the answers and figure out what it is that you understand and what you don't understand. The following week we'll come back and we'll go through it. So the guidance is really in such a way to empower you. And we have the teacher's notes for every single one of these study guides. I'm sure David probably would have explained it the last time he came. But as we're going through it together as a church, we need to get on the same page. We need to make sure that we're united in the same thoughts. And we're going through the easy parts so far. The tougher parts are about to come up. And, you know, we're going to do Law and Grace next. That's usually a tough one. But I believe Joseph is going to be leading out in that one. Yeah, is that right? So the parents are here, so show him no mercy. All right? Question him, ask him, do whatever you want until the dad has to say, that's enough, okay? But I believe Joseph will be coming back this weekend and he'll be leading out in that one. But there are some tougher ones that are coming up. And this is where we have to learn to discuss it, figure out where we all ought to stand as a church as well, okay? But thank you all for coming out. Are there any last questions before we close here for this evening? Yes.
Last week we did a study on marriage.
Okay, sorry. Who's got the mic? So last week, it's about the marriage study? Okay.
And there was this text in Matthew 24, verse 38, where it says that For in the as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark.
Yep.
So in the question that was asked in the handout, says that what would be one of the signs of the last days? And the answer, according to what was given in the guide, was there would be people be marrying, and as a result, marrying, but they also getting divorced.
Yes.
So Dr. O, he looked up the text in the Greek, yes. And he said that there's nothing in the Greek to even give any kind of indication that a divorce was happening when you
yep.
use the term marriage yep. and giving in marriage. So maybe we could get some clarification.
It's just a structural sentence that we use that can go either way. Many people have used that text for marriage and divorce. So, I mean, if you want to go into the Greek and the Hebrew, definitely, you don't see a hint of divorce there, but the sentence structure can still allude to that, you know. But does it say the word divorce? No, it doesn't. It doesn't. It's just the signs of the times. Yeah. Okay? Yes.
I'm still troubled by Danny's question. God,
the one question, regarding this study.
That God knew that Jesus was resurrected in 3 days,
okay.
And why punish him? Are there elements in the plan of salvation but either both of them do not know the outcome? Well, Jesus could have failed. That's one thing. If God knew everything on that outcome, then it's just a show. It's just a show. He knew everything already. Are there elements in the plan of salvation where there is a chance of failure? Okay. Second question was this. Who resurrected Jesus Christ? That is the thing that, you know, is it who resurrected Jesus? Is it by himself or is it God who gave him life? That is very important, because if it is God the Father who gave life back to Jesus Christ, then we can say that God knew everything, you know, he is everything. But if there's a chance that it Christ, by his own life, eternal life that he has, by his God power, he calls up, could it be possible that because if there's an element of sin in him, he could not resurrect himself?
I think there are two different elements here that you have to be careful when we're dealing with this sort of topic. First, there's a human element. What I've brought out in the study is a human element. What I'm about to answer you is a theological element that I would never teach to someone when I teach this. But God did know, or else he's not God. God did know that Jesus, God sees the end from the beginning. He's lived this through and through. God is not bound by time. So did he know that Christ would be victorious? Yes. There's a difference between predestination and foreknowledge. And many times as Christians, we get this mixed up. No one is predestined, but does God know? Yes. He's a God of the living, not the dead. He lives through every moment. He's present in the past, he's present in the present, he's present in the future. Does he see the fire come down from heaven and destroying the sinners right now? Yeah, he does. He knows every element of it. He's not bound by time as we are. Right now, we're just stuck in the present, and that's all we can be. But God isn't. He's past, present, and future. So did he know whether Christ will be resurrected? Yes. Did he control the events to that point? No.
Isn't there, in the spirit of prophecy, where there it says there's an element possibility of failure?
Yes. There is a possibility of failure. Because so, of the freedom of choice,
freedom
free will.
Of choice.
But not because God does not know. Right? God knows, or else he's not God. You see that? But I would never bring that up in the study, okay? We're dealing with a human element. Do you understand that? Do not get bogged down by the... You see, you two have done too much reading. 1,000 lines of Ellen White come out when we're going through one question. You got to learn to filter that and put it aside. So that's why I understand where you're coming from. But when you're teaching someone about the love of God, you have to have the human element behind it. So it's not, God is not just God sitting on the throne. I know the past, present, and future, and now it's time for my son to die, and he moves on, emotionless. No, God's the one that gave us emotions. He gave us the capacity to love, to feel love, to joy, have joy and happiness. And with that, unfortunately, with sin came the sorrow. And I'm sure he felt it in his heart too. So it just depends which picture you want to paint.
I think the topic of how much God knows is a hot topic also for theologians. I was taught by Dr. Probonja, who sat at the feet of Paul Tillich, and he got his PhD. Paul Tillich's main strength of theology was God's foreknowledge. So a lot of things can be said about it, but enough said that it's a hot topic.
In other words, we agree to disagree.
We don't know the final answer, that there are quite a lot of opinions.
Okay. Any other questions? Oh, at the very back. One last one and then we'll close, as the Sabbath is coming to an end.
After hearing the discussion, who decides that Jesus will die on the cross? Was it God, the Father, or the Jews?
Or the Jews? Neither. It was Jesus. He said, I lay down my life and I will take it up again. When the angel called Jesus forth from the tomb, the angel was not giving life that was given to the angel and then given to Jesus. Jesus, he chose to take it up again. And this is one of the things that even the Adventists struggled when Ellen White wrote in The Desire of Ages, in him was life, unborrowed, underived. They really struggled with that. But they forgot that Jesus himself was God as well. So he laid it down. He's like, okay, I mean, we could say it in this sense, but okay, I'm going down. And in 3 days, I'm going to come back up again.
What I meant is the method that Jesus were to die on the cross, the cross itself. Who decides that in order for Jesus to pay the penalty of sin, that it has to be that figure, structure of cross? Is it God the Father? Or the Jews has chose the Romans' way of crucifixion for Jesus to die?
I'm not sure I'm getting it 100%, but I'm going to try again.
I think I understand, Helen. What if Jesus died by an abscess in his foot when he was walking, you know, and he got poked by something and he got infected and then he died? Would that count rather than dying on the cross?
Is that? Oh, the way of dying?
Oh, yeah, way of dying. Why should it be the cross? Why couldn't it be a pneumonia? Why couldn't it be an abscess on the foot or cancer of the liver or something, you know? Why should it
There's
be?
There's too much prophecy to say otherwise.
But that's the kind of questions that people ask who don't read prophecy, who don't read the
right.
Bible.
So here's the thing, you know, we'll never get to the point in our life where we say God controlled us. But yet God is still in control. I determine who's the next king coming, right? I raise up kingdoms, I set up kingdoms, I bring them down. God's still in control. But yet, Belshazzar could never say, God, you did this. No, we write in the history book, Cyrus came and redirected the river. So who? Human and God. In a sense, but no one will ever turn around and say, God, you controlled me to do this. No. No, it's all by freedom of choice. So, yeah, I hope it answers. All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for coming out. Shall we close our time together with prayer? And we'll close the Sabbath together as well. Let's pray. Oh, let's stand, shall we? Our Father in heaven, Lord, I thank you for reminding us today again of the cross. It should be the theme of all that we think about. It should be the very center of our hope. And Lord, help us never to get tired of seeing this, of contemplating it, of meditating on it all day long. For Lord, I know that if we do that, within our hearts would come up great love for Thee. And so, Lord, I pray that You'd please help us to go forth from this place filled with that love, that as we go forth in this new week, the desire to do right, the motive to do right, would spring from this very thought. May You please help us to live for You this coming week. Help us to remember that You're coming soon to take us home again as well. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen.